Thank you, Minister. And that ends this session of portfolio questions. The next item of business is a statement by Keith Brown on the Queensferry crossing. And the Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of his statement. Therefore, there should be no interventions or interruptions. I would actually ask members who do wish to ask a question, however, to press their request to speak buttons when the Minister is on his feet. I'll give the Minister a few minutes. I call on Keith Brown.
Presiding Officer, I'd like to take this opportunity to provide further information to Parliament on the progress of the Queensferry Crossing construction project. Last week, the contractor for the Forth Replacement Crossing, Forth Crossing Bridge Constructors FCBC, submitted an updated construction programme for the Forth Replacement Crossing project following a detailed analysis of the overall impact of weather to date. Since the project began, like all major projects, we have, of course, encountered a series of challenges. Although each of these challenges has been overcome, they have nevertheless taken time to resolve. And as a result, not least in relation to the weather we had last year, much of the contractor's contingency time has been used up. Since deck lifting operations commenced in September last year, the downtime due to adverse weather, specifically wind, has been 40% compared to the 25% anticipated by the contractor. Until May, FCBC believed that they could mitigate these weather effects. However, the impact of the weather in April and May was particularly severe, with 13 days and 12 days lost to weather, respectively. As a result, FCBC have advised ministers that due to the combined effects of the time lost in these 2 months, they can no longer deliver the December 2016 target opening date for the structure. It is important to remind Parliament that the contractual completion date for the bridge is actually June 2017. December 2016, though, was a target date that would have seen the bridge open 6 months ahead of contract. I advise Parliament of the changes to the expected opening date earlier today. I should also stress that what I'm reporting to Parliament today is a very recent development. As recently as March, I visited the construction site and I was assured by FCBC the project remained on schedule to complete by December 2016. Every possible measure has been taken by the contractor in a sustained effort to meet the December 2016 target. In all of these actions, I think it's very important to stress, they ensured that health and safety of the workforce has been paramount. In order to mitigate the ongoing weather impacts that have arisen over the past few months, FCBC has procured additional physical resource, increased staffing by taking on 100 additional workers, increased working hours, altered construction methodologies, again consistent with safety, done that where possible, and also challenged critical construction sequences to identify where any programme efficiencies could be found. The contractors have now reached a stage where further additional resources will not bring the delivery date forward due to the complex technical nature of the construction work, which means that a complex sequence of operations must be used to complete this innovative structure. The deck lifting itself, Presiding Officer, has to be carried out in a balanced sequence on each side of the three towers. You can't do two on one side and then just one on the other. The balance has got to be kept, so one has to follow the other. The loads applied by the various construction activities like road surfacing and crucially the wind barriers have to be very carefully controlled across the structure to ensure its structural integrity. Under robust challenge from ministers, FCBC have confirmed that they had firmly believed up to May this year that their previous programme showing the December 2016 target date for opening to traffic could still be met with the help of the mitigating actions which were being taken, albeit it was becoming increasingly challenging due to the continuing weather impacts. The subsequently revised FCBC programme submitted on the 1st of June has already been the subject of extensive internal challenge by senior management within the FCBC partner companies. The programme includes the effects of weather to date and the impact this has on pushing future activities into periods of greater weather risks, including particularly weather-sensitive activities such as waterproofing, road surfacing, and, as I've mentioned, the installation of wind barriers. The contractor has also built in allowances for future weather based on the experience to date. Over the last week, independent experts employed by Transport Scotland have also provided further robust challenge to FCBC's revised programme, analysing each critical activity to ensure that everything possible is done to ensure an opening date as close to December as possible. This review concluded that all that could be done was being done to open the bridge as soon as it's safe to do so. FCBC has also assured us that they will continue to target the earliest possible date that the structure can be safely opened to traffic. However, at this stage, the programme shows that the Queensferry crossing is now expected to be open by mid-May 2017, prior to the actual contractual completion date of mid-June 2017, but of course some months after our projected target date of the end of this year. We will continue to work closely with the contractors, and I will personally ensure that every pressure and every resource is brought to bear to deliver safely, or indeed better, than in advance of the date which I've just mentioned of May next year. To date, FCBC has successfully managed every risk to the construction of the project that is within their control. The only risk the contractor has no control over is weather, although they have made significant efforts to mitigate weather effects where possible. Ministers, Presiding Officer, have always been ambitious about this project, and in being so, the project has always worked to a deliberately ambitious target of December 2016. Originally, Parliament may recall, this timescale was set to address concerns about the long-term condition of the Forth Road Bridge, where it was originally believed that it would suffer usage restrictions, HGVs having to come off the bridge, as early as 2017. These concerns, notwithstanding the problems we had in the bridge more recently, have proven to be less immediate, and the recently installed structural health monitoring system on the Forth Road Bridge is providing additional surety on the ability of the existing bridge to sustain traffic loading into the future. However, that hadn't decreased our determination to complete this once-in-a-generation project at the earliest opportunity, as I say, consistent with safety. It's important to stress that FCBC fully expect the project to be complete well within the timeframe of their contract. We will not meet the December opening target. It remains true that the project itself will be completed by the contractual date, and additionally, Presiding Officer, there will be no impact on the public purse. I'd like to confirm in that regard there will be no additional cost to taxpayers, and that our previous projection of a £245 million saving will still be the case after this announcement. The project directly employs over 1,200 people, many of whom have been performing some of the most complex civil engineering ever seen in Scotland, in the highly challenging environment of the Firth of Forth. Over 12 million work hours have gone into the project so far, and we should not lose sight of the hard work and dedication of that workforce. Anyone who looks at the works in the Forth cannot fail to be impressed with their achievements to date. We have been and will continue to be fully transparent about the delivery of this project, both in terms of cost and timescale, providing regular updates to Parliament, communities and the public. And with this in mind, Presiding Officer, I'd like to offer the opportunity to any interested MSPs from across the Chamber to attend a dedicated technical briefing this Friday, when any questions which members may have, which they don't get the opportunity to ask just now, can be asked and answered. It's important to remember, Presiding Officer, in my view, that in the space of around 9 years, remarkable progress has been made in advancing this project from feasibility study to near completion. As you'd also mentioned, it's the expectation of the contractors, their expectation based on the robust timescale they've laid out, that 94% of the project will be complete by the end of this year. But it's expected the project will be largely complete with both the approach roads, or the approach roads on both sides, ready for traffic, and a continuous structure spanning the Forth. And by the middle of next year, the May date that I've mentioned, traffic will be flowing across it. That's the timescale laid out by the contractor, which we will hold them to and try to improve on. The Scottish Government, for our part, will continue to ensure that this iconic structure brings benefits to the people of Scotland at the earliest opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions. There's been a large number of members wish to speak, so if members could all keep their questions and their answers relatively brief, we'll get through them all. Mr. Fraser, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his statement and for the advance copy, and indeed for answering my written parliamentary question earlier this morning. I'm sure all of us in the Chamber would wish to applaud the contractors working on this ambitious and challenging infrastructure project, particularly in the difficult weather conditions the Cabinet Secretary has outlined. My constituents in Fife and across the east of Scotland well remember the catastrophe at the end of the last year when the Forth Road Bridge was closed for weeks, causing huge disruption to people's lives and untold damage to the local economy. At that time, we were assured by the Scottish Government that the long-awaited new crossing would be delivered on time and under budget. On the 5th of January this year, the First Minister told this chamber, and I quote, "By the end of this year, the new Queensferry crossing will be completed." No ifs, no buts, no maybes, no dependent on the weather, a clear promise, and one which today has clearly been broken. The people I represent in Fife and further afield will be dismayed at today's announcement of a delay and worry about the implications. So can the Cabinet Secretary help them by answering these three questions? Firstly, what guarantee can he now give about the new date for completion of mid-May? Is this also weather dependent? And can we have more confidence in this date than in the First Minister's previous assurance? Secondly, given that the existing road bridge will have to carry heavy traffic for up to 6 months longer than previously planned, can he assure us that it is up to the task and there is no risk of a further catastrophic closure, either to cars or to HGVs? And finally, is it true that contractors working on the new bridge were aware of this delay some weeks ago and were asked to sign confidentiality agreements not to disclose this information until after the Scottish Parliament elections on the 5th of May?
Cabinet Secretary.
A series of questions there from Murdo Fraser. The first point he made was about the weather, and I would, in addition to any other spokespersons from other parties, make the offer to say that if they'd like to come to the top of the towers of the bridge, because there is a perception, I think we have to acknowledge the fact from people that they see... I'll be happy to accompany Murdo Fraser on that visit.
Walking behind them.
I think there is a point where the public see what they believe to be relatively fine weather, but it can be a completely different environment on top of those towers, as I can testify myself. And I think it is important, actually, on the website today of Transport Scotland, if members want to see the video of the two men in the basket pulling the strands for the cables, we get some idea of the pressures which are there. I think it's also true to say it's never been the case. We've said no ifs, no buts. I'm not resiling from the target date that we had. I've said that repeatedly. But if you look at the testimony given to the committees of this Parliament, by Transport Scotland, by the contractors, they have always talked about weather. Weather is a one variable which, as I've said earlier, they cannot control. In relation to the new date and the confidence which surrounds that, I would say that the confidence on the part of the contract, and I have to take the words of the contract, although of course we get Transport Scotland to interrogate these things and we in turn interrogate Transport Scotland as well as the contractor. Their confidence is based on their experience right up to date of the weather during the most critical part of this project, which has been over the last few months. As I say, they expect, their intention is to have 94% of the project complete by the end of this year, and that will allow sufficient time to make sure they can finish by the date they've given me of mid-May. I will do everything that I can to hold them to that project, but yes, to be perfectly blunt to Murdo Fraser, weather is still a factor, and that we cannot control. I can also confirm to Murdo Fraser that the existing road bridge is perfectly able to take any traffic, as it has been now for quite a number of months. In addition to the work that was carried out to effect the repairs which were necessary on the bridge, you may remember that those repairs had a further few stages to go to make it permanent repairs. Those are on target. There is no question of the bridge having to close. In addition to that, we had a full health check of the existing bridge. And also the crucial point, the reason why we ended up in the first place with a December 2016 target was because we expected, because of the cables which were examined back in the 2000s, which had shown moisture, could necessitate the removal of HGVs from the existing Forth Road Bridge. Back in 2012, Parliament may remember, we had those looked at again, dehumidification was carried out, and we are confident in the ability of the cables to carry the traffic in future that is required to carry. The Forth Road Bridge, in summary, will be carrying traffic for many years to come, and we are confident in that. I have no knowledge whatsoever, and certainly the Scottish Government has never entered into any confidentiality agreements with contractors saying that they cannot speak about this until, I think he said, after the election. I repeat the timescale which I have given them. This was in May this year, April and May were the months when they lost most days, which have necessitated this change. I'm happy to provide Murdo Fraser with a timeline on that, and I would conclude by once again inviting Murdo Fraser, any other spokespeople, to come up top of the bridge and see what the weather is like for themselves.
Alec Rowley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's announcement will be greeted with disappointment in Fife and beyond. As someone who has campaigned for a new crossing for decades, I would say, whilst the delay is disappointing, we need to keep it in perspective and make clear that this new bridge is good news for Fife good news for the east of Scotland, indeed good news for the whole economy of Scotland. That is why it's important that ministers do not announce unrealistic deadlines, and it's crucial that there is full transparency on this project. Can the minister firstly confirm that there are no further concerns with the existing bridge and that the volume of traffic it carries every day is not a concern? Second, when did the government become aware of the delays on the new crossing? And finally, if bad weather in April and May has delayed this project by 6 months, what steps is the minister taking to ensure that bad weather this winter does not delay the opening even further? And can he therefore commit that June 2017 is absolutely the latest day at which this bridge will open?
Cabinet Secretary.
I would say to Alec Riley, first of all, I do agree with him. This is very good news. And I think sometimes we lose sight of the fact of how unique this structure is. If you think just of the central span, it will be the longest structure of its type in the world, the longest structure ever built in terms of the cables which support that. And there are huge challenges. Alec Riley knows just as well as me, I live on the other side of the Forth as well, the challenges which you can have in the Forth. And that's what's allowed for this disappointment we're having to express today about the timeline in terms of the end of the year. It is good news for Scotland. We think this is hugely beneficial. I would love for this decision to have been taken many years ago when we were further down the road with that, but it's not. We took the decision and we moved on this very quickly. Alec Riley, I don't think, was in Parliament at the time, but we actually started the procurement at the same time as we started the legislation in order to try and get this bridge done as quickly as was possible. On his point about full transparency, I've already said any member, including Alec Riley, that wants to go along on Friday, ask any of the contractors, ask any of Transport Scotland officials that will be there, any questions which he has, which he feels have not been answered today, will be answered. There's also a great deal of transparency already occurred by the attendance at committees of this Parliament by Transport Scotland and by the contractor. Alec Riley also asked about the existing bridge. I think I've given those assurances which I can to Murdo Fraser. The action that was necessary to get the bridge back into operation was taken. There are still further steps which will not jeopardise the continued use of the bridge, but will further ensure the bridge is made safe for the future, going well into the future. We have a full health check done on the bridge because of the work that was required recently, and also the point about the cables. The cables have had a process of dehumidification, and that risk has receded from where it was as we expected back in 2005. And as to continuing to make sure we get this at the earliest possible date, I've given the undertaking in my statement that I will be doing that personally, as we have been doing, and we will make sure that we consistent with safety, because we never, and the contractors, I have to say, I've been very impressed by their approach to safety. The chief contractor, Michael Martin, who's in charge of the whole project, meets with every new member of staff coming on, and they all ask about the priority, and they all say it's getting the bridge open. He says, no, it's not, it's safety. So that will be the approach that's taken. But consistent with that, I will be making sure that everything possible is being done, along with the contractors and Transport Scotland, to make sure we open this bridge as soon as possible.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to the Cabinet Secretary for his statement and indeed for the advanced copy that we saw before now. Much about this statement now suggests a project in abject distress. How on earth does 25 days lost to weather in April and May equate to a 180-day delay in opening the bridge? Does he take us for fools? And does he now expect Parliament to believe that the first that ministers learned of this was just conveniently days after the Scottish election? And will the minister now publish all correspondence pertaining to a potential delay in the opening of this crossing?
Cabinet Secretary.
The idea that this is a project in abject distress will produce, I'm sure, some distress in the workforce that are working on this project. They think they're involved. They think they're involved in a fantastic and unique project which will benefit the infrastructure of Scotland. And to hear that kind of statement from Alex Cole-Hamilton does him no credit whatsoever. It's also true to say that you wouldn't find a project in abject distress that had a saving of £254 million attached to it. If you compare that, for example, to the cost of the Lib Dems' favoured trams project in Edinburgh, then I think you'll see that was a project in abject distress. I've said already we will have full transparency. I've said the process by which that will be carried out. Of course, any documents which are required and we can release, there are issues of commercial confidentiality, none of which amount to any statement trying to get anybody to not speak to anybody, not on the part of the Scottish Government. But we do have, of course, information we can make available. I commit to making sure that information is made available. But over and above that, any question that's requiring to be asked by any member of either the contractor, Transport Scotland, of course, can be done on Friday. And I would repeat the offer. I don't know whether, I generally don't know whether Alex Cole Hamilton is his party's spokesperson in relation to this subject. I know he is a local member, but if he wants to come along, either in that capacity or as a spokesperson to the bridge, I'll make sure that happens as well. There is no shepherding of the officials or the contractor by ministers. They are open to answer any question which is required. I think we have ensured transparency. We'll continue to do that. And I deplore the comments of Alex Cole Hamilton in talking about an abject distress.
Jenny Gilruth.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Cabinet Secretary what steps have been taken to keep the Queensferry crossing project on schedule.
Cabinet Secretary.
As I've mentioned, every possible measure has been taken by the contractor in what's been a sustained effort to meet the December 2016 target. And just to once again repeat, of course, I and everyone else, as Alec Rowley says, will be disappointed that we cannot meet that target. But they have procured additional physical resources. They've increased the staffing, taking on an additional 100 workers. They've increased working hours consistent with safety, and again, consistent with safety, altered construction methodologies where possible. They've also challenged the critical construction sequences to identify where any programme efficiencies could be found. And somebody, I think it was Alec Cole Hamilton, said, why is it the case that the days which have been lost in April and May are so critical? If you think about the bridge, it has to be completed in a sequential manner. You have as limited as two people working in a very small space at the crucial points when the decks, where the decks are lifted. So that does produce constraints which no amount of additional resources can now recover because of the time lost. But the contractors confirmed that at this stage, further additional resources will not bring the delivery date forward, partly for the reasons I've mentioned and partly because of the complex technical nature of the construction work and the sequence of operations that must now be undertaken to complete the structure. But everything possible is being done consistent with safety to make sure we bring this in as soon as possible.
Alex Johnson.
During the period where the timescale was being reviewed, the project suffered its first and thankfully so far its only casualty. Could the Minister tell me if during the period the days were lost in the construction process as a result of that incident? But further, given the anecdotal suggestions that there may be health and safety compromises taking place, can he guarantee once again that the pressure he has undertaken to place on the contractors and management of the project will not result in compromises over health and safety?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say, first of all, that the tragic death to which Alec Johnson refers was a Mr. John Cousin, who I think everybody on the bridge knew as a very popular person, somebody very committed to the bridge and the project. It's probably hard to convey how devoted to the project those people that are working on it are. It is unique and it's produced a real loyalty to it. And it was, of course, tragic that Mr. Cousin lost his life. And quite rightly, that has been investigated by the Health and Safety Executive. Yes, there was a delay. The bridge was closed in respect of Mr. Cousin for 2 days, and once again for 1 day, I think it was, on his funeral. I am not going to be applying any pressure which jeopardises safety. I've made that clear to the contractors, but more importantly, the contractors have made clear to me they will not be doing anything which jeopardises safety. They had, of course, until that tragic accident, a very good record in terms of safety. So I will not be doing anything which jeopardises that. I think that was all the questions which Alec Johnson asked, but if there's any more, then he can come back to me.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Cabinet Secretary, given the weather dependence of the Queensferry crossing construction, what other aspects of work have seen weather-related delays?
Cabinet Secretary.
Weather can have varying impacts on construction activities. However, the critical activities which have been delayed due to wind in particular have been deck lifting and cabling operations. Since that work, that part of the work commenced in September last year, the downtime due to adverse weather, specifically wind, has been 40% compared to the 25% anticipated by the contractor for this activity. And that, in turn, creates an unavoidable knock-on effect for subsequent activities, road surfacing and wind barriers. The wind barrier cannot be put onto the bridge until the bridge is substantially complete, because if it does, it will produce an unacceptable stress on the structure. That will now have to take place in wet and cold conditions during autumn and winter 2016-17. Overall, the contingency built into the construction programme from 2011 was 20%, but much of that was eroded during the weather that we had last year.
Emma Harper.
Neil Bibby. In the interests of full transparency, will the government publish all dates from the start of the project that were affected by adverse weather? And as has just been mentioned, in terms of safety, we can't forget, as just been mentioned, the death earlier this year of a worker helping to build the bridge. Can the Cabinet Secretary assure us that he's spoken to the trade unions to assure them that there will be no undue pressure put on as a result of the timescale of the project?
Cabinet Secretary.
On the last point that Neil Bibby raises, that's properly done by the contractor. I conveyed my views to the contractor. The contractor is the employer, and they've done that. So the idea that we would allow for or pressure the contractor into doing things which were not consistent with safety, we just wouldn't do that. I'm sorry, I've just forgotten the first part of Neil Bibby's question. Well, I would say that we already have the data for the crucial periods, April to May, which shows day by day when it was not possible because the wind at the crucial levels exceeded, in one case, I think it's 28 miles an hour for the cabling operations and 35 miles an hour for the deck lift. So we have that information for the crucial period. I will check what further information is available going further back, and of course we'll produce all the information and pass it on indeed to Neil Bibby and to any other member that's interested.
David Torrance.
Secretary, whether problems with the marine foundations of the new crossings have played any part in this delay?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can say that they have not. The contractor has confirmed to us that they firmly believed up to May that the previous programme showing the December 2016 target date for opening to traffic could still be met with, as I've said, the help of the mitigating actions, albeit that it was becoming increasingly challenging due to the continuing weather impacts. But in relation to the point that David Torrance raises around the marine foundations, no, they haven't played a part in the delay.
Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his statement, an advance copy of it. In his statement, he said that back in March of this year, when he visited the site, that he was guaranteed that it would be completed by December of this year. If that guarantee has now been broken, what confidence can we have that this project will be delivered under budget? Now that he's missed this target, what other targets will he miss?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Jeremy Balfour's question was about, apart from the other questions, was about the budget. There is going to be no impact. We've projected, and it's worth repeating, a saving of £245 million. Now, just to be clear, this project, when it was first tendered, was for a tender range, I think, of between 1.75 and 2.25 or thereabouts billion pounds. We expected to come in around 1.3 billion pounds. But the savings since the earlier figure came in after the tender are around £245 million, and they are not impacted by this delay. Any further work having to be done, any further resources having to be applied, are done at the expense of the contractor. He asks again the question about the guarantees. I've tried to be specific in saying that the mid-May date that we've been given by the contractor has been robustly investigated. We've made the same point that Jeremy Balfour just made to me. We do not want to be announcing or applying a date which cannot be met. We are told by the contractor they can do it in that time. They have, of course, until June for the contract date to end. But we will do what we can in the meantime, everything that we can, to try and work with the contractor through Transport Scotland to make sure that that date of mid-May next year, which is what they've said they can do, and they have given the usual caveat around weather, they've said they can do that. We'll do everything to do we can do to make sure they either meet that or indeed improve on that, and I'll give that personal guarantee.
Claire Baker.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary has said that he aims to be fully transparent. What steps will be taken over the next 6 months to ensure that local partners are kept informed of the progress? Because my understanding is, until the statement was made today, people weren't aware that a delay was about to be announced.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say to Claire Baker on her last point, we can only announce it when we have that information. I've said how recently it was that information came to us. She's right to say, of course, communities and stakeholders want to be kept up to date. And I think there's been an excellent track record from the project on both sides of the bridge of communities there in keeping them involved and up to date. And I undertake to make sure, in relation to what we've announced today, that that information is passed out to those communities and that they're kept up to date during the rest of the construction project.
And our last question, Bruce Crawford.
Presiding Officer, I'm glad the Cabinet Secretary has confirmed that there will be no impact on the public purse as a result of the delay. But I'm curious, Cabinet Secretary, can you please let me know whether any finance has been released to the Forth Crossing Bridge constructors for meeting contractual milestones in accordance with the December 2016 target?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course we have paid for the... It's one of those, I suppose, odd projects in that John Swinney had to pay for this project as we went along. It wasn't like a normal project where you could take other action for borrowing. So we've had to pay for this project. And, of course, any monies due to the contractor have been paid. Can I just say, though, in conclusion to Bruce Crawford, this is very disappointing. If you link of the recent record in terms of large-scale public infrastructure projects, the M74 delivered on time and on budget, the M80 delivered on time and on budget, Airdrie to Bathgate, the Borders Railway, we've taken great strides in making sure we bring these projects in on time, on budget. This project will come in substantially under budget, and it's with great regret that we cannot meet the original timescale that we had, but we undertake to do everything that we can to get this project in by the end of the contract date, the target date being the mid-May next year, and we'll try and improve on that.
That ends questions on the ministerial statement. Apologies to those who wish to ask questions but weren't called. The next